Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode 65 of the J Situation Podcast. I'm recording this on June 1st, 2021. Man, wild ride today, tell you what. Tons of social media attention. That was actually, it was a little overwhelming, a little bit insane. We'll talk about that in today's episode. Speaking of insane, the mosquitoes are back. That's right. It's very nice. It's great when the mosquitoes come back. You know, tons of rain down here in Texas lately. And man, nothing like hot, humid, with a surplus of fresh mosquito larva. Just, it really makes your evening so great in your yard. Right? Oh, what's that? You want to take a photo for your podcast? I'm sorry. I didn't know you didn't want 6,000 mosquitoes to suck a pint of blood out of your face. I didn't know that. Man, I thought you wanted malaria. Man, I grew up with mosquitoes on the Gulf Coast, actually. And you know, man, you guys, I don't know if any of you have lived in those types of locales, but yeah. You remember the sound of those mosquito trucks? Good times. Those poison trucks were so loud. Man, the things we as humans do to destroy pests. It is interesting what lengths we'll go to. You know, one thing I wanted to get my mom. I wanted to get my mom the other day, but she refuses. I wanted to get her a suppressed Ruger Mark IV, like a .22-45 or something. You know, just so she can ice the armadillos that have been digging up her garden. She uses traps instead. She's like super particular. I'm like, Mom, just let me give you some weapons. She's such a pacifist. She's definitely not into violence. I'm like, come on, let's get violent. Let's get violent with these armadillos. But she doesn't want to, so it's fine. But you know, one thing my mom could do is like from the comfort of her own couch with her phone, is buy a silencer from Silencer Shop. The J Situation Podcast is proudly sponsored by Silencer Shop, the most efficient and intelligent way to purchase silencers. As a silencer consumer, Silencer Shop is not only my dealer of choice, but it is my national silencer infrastructure of choice. They've done a lot of cool stuff. They create an easy system that minimizes the likelihood of errors in your paperwork. They pioneered the use of a QR code on the actual Form 4, so the ATF can scan the code instead of inputting all your data themselves. It's really great. I tell you what, man, they save you time. They save all of us time. It is quite monumental what they've contributed to the state of practice in the regulatory arena, as it were. It's almost insane when you really think about it. There's a reason they've grown. They continue to innovate and do things like that, and you know, get those variances from the ATF. And it's super important. And you know, they have a network of dealers nationwide where silencers are legal. You use their kiosk there, sitting on your couch with your fingerprints and photos electronically. You cut down on errors. You simplify your silencer purchasing process. There's a money back guarantee. It's great, man. No transfer fees. No paperwork errors. Just you and your silencer, with no drama. It truly is silencer ownership simplified. And secondly, if that weren't enough advertisement, the J Situation Podcast is also sponsored by PEW Science, pushing the silencer industry forward, kicking and screaming, clawing its way through the doorway, one test at a time. Visit PewScience.com for the suppression rating, the simplest and most accurate hearing safe ratings for your suppressed small arms. I am the owner and technical director of PewScience. It is my company. I have chosen to sponsor this podcast that I also do. It is a decision that I made that is important. It is a concerted effort to educate the world about suppressed small arms. And when I talk about hearing safe ratings and the suppression rating, it is based on true human sound perception. Okay, it's in Section 5 of the Silencer Sound Standard on PewScience.com. The standard is a reference document for all of you, and it will walk you through gunshot noise It's a very simplified, abbreviated Wikipedia on silencer sound and gunshot sound, essentially. Okay, it walks you. It starts at the fundamentals, and it moves all the way through hearing effects into the review metrics that we use for you on the website. Okay, so it's basically the sound bible for suppressed small arms now. Okay, it's pretty cool, you know. And there's 7 parts. They're all on PEWScience.com for you to read. And, you know, if you haven't seen it, don't want to dig through it, that's fine. You don't need to. Just save it for a rainy day. For now, skip to Section 5. You see the suppression rating. It'll let you know kind of what's what. It'll have you get your bearing. And it'll let you know how silencers stack up in comparison to one another with regard to sound at the muzzle and at the shooter's ear. And that number, that suppression rating, it'll give you a hearing safe dose limit for the particular platforms on which the silencers are tested, and it's directly tied to human perception. If it's higher, it'll sound better. If it's lower, it'll sound more harsh to you. Okay, pretty simple. You're not going to find this information anywhere else in the world. And the 6th section of the standard has all the reviews there. Go check them out on PEWScience.com. And again, if that's too much, you go to Section 7, PEWScience Rankings. You can sort it. It's a database tool. Super simple. And, you know, more rankings are added every time we add public data to the website. And if you see anything in that table that interests you, there are links in the table that'll take you back to the detailed reviews, and you can nerd out on the data all day long. You know, it's okay. Go wild. No problem. It's important. It's important to be curious and read. So, as always, if you are a manufacturer and you would like to use PEWScience for private testing and consulting services, there is a form on the website with which you can submit that inquiry. As always, your contact information, all the test data, it's all held in strict confidence. That is all client confidential information with PEWScience. That is not released to the public. Nothing, actually, is released to the public unless, of course, you choose to release the data that is produced for you. And if that occurs, if you make that desire known to PEWScience, we will work with you to do that. We have done that a couple times, okay? And you can support this podcast. You can. You can support it. You can support PEWScience. You can support the testing that we do for the community at large by joining with a membership at PEWScience.com. And, you know, if you say, you know, Jay, I just can't do it this month or ever. I have a very tight budget. And frankly, sir, I pack my lunch every day, and I would never dream of spending a monthly stipend on PEWScience support. I say, hey, bro, I am not one to question your personal finances. Believe me. Hey, I respect that. That's fine. But, you know, you don't have to spend money. All you got to do is spread the word. It's very nice. You know, and we'll talk about that today. Some folks have been doing that benevolently, and it is very nice, and it helps normalize suppressed small arms. The overarching goal of PEWScience at the end of the day, when the dust is settled, what is the impetus? What is the goal? What is the actual thrust of the effort? Well, it's education. It's normalization of suppressed small arms for broad use. How will we build the proper army without suppressed small arms? Yeah, there's some food for thought for you today. Okay, give the podcast 5 stars on iTunes. All right, 4 topics for you today. Topic 1, the PEWScience army. It does exist, which is interesting. Also, powerful grand thumb. Also, new sound signature review this week, so buckle up for that. Topic 2, what do you actually need on your 5.56 SBR or short barrel upper? Might not be an SBR, might be a machine gun. What do you actually need on your short barrel stoner rifle in 5.56? I don't know, no idea actually, but sure, I know short silencers could be cool, so we'll talk about that. Topic 3, listener questions. Let us continue our journey together. Topic 4, welcome to new PEWScience members. Members of PEWScience, lend me your ears. No, your support means the world. So thank you. Super awesome. Okay, let's get into topic 1 at a time of 9 minutes, 56 seconds. Oh, the Pew Science Army. My goodness. It does exist. It is very interesting to me, this phenomenon that we have started to notice over the past year or so. I mean, it's been accelerating. It is interesting to me, and powerful Grand Thumb today. And there's a new sound signature review coming this week. So much things in this topic. I tell you what, I really appreciate you folks spreading the word. I really do. I say that at the intro of every podcast. I say, you know, if you could be so kind, spread the word. You know, it helps. And it has been very nice that you have been doing that because it's been working. I get probably a few messages a week telling me that you folks have walked into your local gun stores, bought silencers, and mentioned Pew Science, and the guys at the gun counters totally know what you're talking about. And the resulting discussions are fruitful. The discussions you have together are fruitful. That is awesome. It's actually happening more frequently than I expected at this point. And it seems to be accelerating, which is nice. It's always good to accelerate this type of phenomenon. And I am pleased. I'm pleased about this. And this goes back to what I said, I think, an episode or two ago about dealers putting QR codes in their shops. I'm going to need to do something special for Pew Science member dealers so they can do that. Stay tuned for that. I have some ideas. Me and my girl were talking about it. We're gonna figure it out. It's been so busy lately. You know, I've been focusing on data and research, so I need to kind of branch off. And we actually have a lot of things to do for you. We have merch. We need merch lined up. We got to give you good swag. I'm not gonna do it like you see a lot of folks do. No, I'm gonna put the work into this. So. You know, we're going to do that right. No, we're going to need placards and QR codes for dealers because we need to make sure, and obviously Pew Science member dealers are going to, and entities are going to get those first, right? Like, of course they're going to get dibs and of course Pew Science members are going to get dibs too first on merch. I mean, that's a no-brainer. But yeah, big picture, I mean, long-term, I think everyone's going to get all of it. So stay tuned for that. You know, that actually brings me to another point. You guys ever seen Fight Club? That movie Fight Club? Well, if you haven't seen Fight Club, I'm totally going to spoil the main plot line for you. So if you have not seen Fight Club and you want to, then you need to go ahead and fast forward through what I'm about to say. Give me 5 minutes. I don't know how long I'm going to take to explain this, but this is your warning. Okay, so that if you don't want me to spoil it for you, that's your warning. So this concludes my spoiler alert. Okay, so in Fight Club, a gentleman, the main character, he's under a lot of stress from his everyday life, so much so that and so caught up in the monotony, really. That he starts losing sleep and he becomes an insomniac, as it were, and he starts hallucinating. His subconscious creates an alter ego of himself, one that is free. It's really free. It's a free ego that it's free of the clutches of his everyday life, the things that he's dealing with that are making him stress, that are constraining him, constraining his creativity, constraining his joy, his lust, his hedonistic desires, everything that's constraining him. The alter ego is free of that. And so he's free when in that ego form to express himself, take risks. He lives with reckless abandon, really. And it's because this is his subconscious, he doesn't realize that it's him doing it. He actually befriends his alter ego, his vision of himself projected. It becomes his friend, his best friend, almost like a brother. And what he does with his alter ego is he creates the so-called Fight Club. It's essentially a pseudo-secret underground organization where like-minded individuals can gather. They gather together, and they relieve stress from their similar dull lives that they have, or their constrained lives that they have. And eventually, this man, he becomes aware of the alter ego. And upon this awareness, he discovers that the alter ego himself, unbeknownst to himself, has set up Fight Club franchises in various cities. And the centralized core of the organization has now become decentralized. And that the hive has sprung detachments from the hive. The Hydra has many heads. Essentially, it's, you know, he is still at the helm, but it's spiraling out of control radically. And why is it? It's because of what his alter ego set in motion without him really being in control. And, you know, really, and at the core of the proliferation of the Fight Club and clubs, it is an effort so honest, so pure and grand that people couldn't help but flock to it and become disciples of it. Almost like a cult of some kind, right? I mean, but it wasn't really a cult. The Fight Club wasn't a cult because the people were free to leave. And in fact, with regard to spreading the word about Fight Club, the first rule of Fight Club is that you don't talk about Fight Club. Well, and the second rule of Fight Club is that you don't talk about Fight Club. it's in the rules, in the Fight Club rule set. So, but it spread anyway, didn't it? If you've seen the movie, it did. And then Pew Science is like Fight Club, but it has the opposite rule set. The first rule of Pew Science is you talk about Pew Science. And the second rule of Pew Science is that you help others. However, you can't help them. Yeah, that's all there is to it. Whether you're helping people through education, assistance in answering questions, anything, to be helpful is the key. Helping people is the directive of Pew Science. You understand? This is very important. It's very important to understand. So yeah, I thought about this the other day when people started telling me that dealers and folks were showing folks my data. I felt like Tyler Durden from Fight Club. I said, well, I was like, holy crap. Wait a second. Did I talk to that dealer? Am I setting up franchises in my sleep? No, honestly, I could be, frankly. Actually, up until I really dug into Pew Science, I did not know what my physical and mental limits of operating under prolonged sleep deprivation were and continuous work were. I didn't know. I think, and I've discovered this, I could be wrong, and I don't mean this to be hyperbolic if it sounds like that. I do think few people understand their true limits of hard work. And I mean, I understand people understand their physical limits, like especially like those of you that have gone through hard military training and survival training, like SEER school, BUDS, what, you know, what at Ranger school, I don't care. Call it whatever. I'm sure you heroes do all kinds of really hard stuff. That's fine. But I'm not talking about just that physical and mental activity, which is hard. I'm talking about more about doing it when you don't have to. Like, what is your threshold? What is your mental and physical threshold in everyday life when you don't have to do something? Like, what is your work ethic threshold, and how do you operate without basic human needs? Like, how do you operate without sleep and rest and recovering in the context of doing something that you don't need to do to survive? How far can you push yourself when you don't need to? I'm not asking you how long can you hold your breath and how long can you hold the boat above your head and training on the beach. I'm not asking you that. I'm asking you, how long can you do something when you absolutely don't have to and no one's telling you to? What if nobody is telling you to do something and you have to get the entire motivation from within and there's no consequence if you fail, but you have to push yourself to it anyway? What's your limit? How does that feel? And when you find that limit, are you going to know it or are you going to push further? And are you going to know when to stop and then pull back so you can continue doing it? Mm-hmm. Yes, that's a good question, right? Because I almost guarantee you that none of you have done that, because it's weird. It doesn't make sense, right? You're like, what do you mean you didn't have to do it? I'm like, yeah, you don't have to. I don't have to do Pew Science. Like, I don't have to do this. So what's making me do it? Yeah, that's the question. Okay. So those limits, well, I know them now. I know my limits. It's important for a man to know his limitations. So, but it is not fun to discover it through brute force. So I recommend, if you do pursue such a thing, not to do it through brute force. Use a more measured approach. But everyone has their own methods, right? Okay. So I think that was important to talk about, because I think some people have questioned my motivation in this, as if there was some kind of ulterior motive. No, you're seeing it unfold. This is literally to help you that are people listening. This is to help people through my own motivation. This is for you by me. Okay? If you have any questions about that, tech@pewscience.com. All right. So the information has been proliferating, and that is in large part due to all of you. And so thank you for that. And the information proliferated so far, in fact, that Mike, Mr. Grantham Man, Grantham from the YouTubes there on the internet. Excuse me. I've spoken with Mike on occasion. He called me the other day. He said, "Hey Jay, hey man, I'm gonna release a silencer video. And I would like to discuss what I'm going to say about silencers with you." I'm paraphrasing. And I thought that was very nice of him to ask me my opinions on what he was going to speak about with regard to silencers. So we spoke, and it was very nice. And he's a very nice guy. But just as importantly, he, so far to me, is honest, and he is sincere. And I see something in him that I respect, I think. I don't know him well enough yet. But I think I see something I respect, and that is, I think he likes to educate people, and he does actually seem to care about good information and getting it to people. He seems genuine to me. He really does. He does seem genuine to me. This morning, he released a video, his video about silencers. I didn't know that it was going to be. I don't keep track of his schedule. We didn't really talk about the particulars. And so I didn't know that, and I also didn't know something else. I did not know he was going to be so nice and say such nice things about Pew Science in the beginning of the video, which he did. He said very nice things. And so today, Pew Science got a lot more followers on social media, so that's nice. I actually didn't realize how many people watched the Grantham Man on the YouTube. See, he seems to have quite a lot of people watching him, like a million people or something. It's like utterly insane like that. I'm like, oh my God, like people love guns, which is good. So that's nice. And gosh, what a nice man to be genuine and sincere, and have that big of a following and use it to show things that are entertaining and with good intentions. How about, I don't watch a lot of YouTube, so I went and watched some of his videos, because I had only seen a few, and I watched some. I was like, gosh, he really does try to drive home some responsible points in his videos. So I thought that was nice. So I hope the folks that arrived to Pew Science via Mr. Grantham Man recently, I hope you folks, if you any of you folks are listening, I hope you decide to stay a while. and maybe you see what Pew Science is all about. Deal? How does that sound? Does that sound okay? That'd be great. So thank you. And Mike, if you're listening, you are a gentleman and a scholar. So thank you, sir. So yeah. I almost forgot. New sound signature review this week. Yeah. I went hard in the paint for you again. I did it fast, but it's almost finished. It's almost finished. I need to polish it. It's the bones are there. No, there's more than bones. There's meat. I think I actually wrote the whole dang thing. I just need to. Well, I need to check it. I don't have an editor, so I need to read it again and again. And I probably need to, you know, I need to hire somebody at this point. I just don't have I can't pay the salary of what I need. I actually need like a technical person. I need like a, what do you call that? Not like a lab assistant, because that's like, I kind of need one of those too. No, I need a, I actually need, I don't know, man. I'm going to see how, maybe when I start selling merch, maybe that'll help. Maybe I can hire someone then. I don't know. We'll have to figure that out as far as like getting enough people to do this, because I think I need some personnel. But yeah, I'm going to polish that review up for you and make it nice and clean for you. So stay tuned this week. You're going to want to see this one. You are. It's important. It's an important one. Should I give you a hint? Hint. We're going to continue looking at technology. There's a hint for you. Okay. It's a very important review. All right. Topic two at a time of 26 minutes and 53 seconds. What do you actually need on your 556 SBR? No idea. I don't know. But short silencers could be cool for you. Let's talk about that. And I mean, actually, like when I ask you, like I'm going to tell you what you need, like I'm going to tell you what to buy on your, Jay says, you're going to put this on your rifle. No, no, no. What do I look like? Mr. Grantham Man? I am most certainly not him. Or that, for that matter, that Lucas guy. You seen that Lucas guy? He shoots very, very, very fast, very quickly. He's also very nice. Lucas, he's a T-Rex Arms is his company. He has a company too. He seems like a nice person. I spoken with him very briefly in the DMs there. He slid into my DMs. He's a nice person. And I watched some of his videos. He seems genuine too. It's funny. Mr. Grand Thumb Man that I talked about in the previous topic and this Lucas guy, they both seem very genuine. And then I watched, there was a video, they were together and they shot together. They had their rifles there and they were talking about their rifles. They did the tip to butt thing that the Grand Thumb Man does. They looked at the rifles. It's nice. It's like, oh, they're like shooting friends. They're like gun friend people. That's cool. It's neat to have friends that shoot guns. That's not, actually, some people take that for granted. That's not normal everywhere, you know. So that was really great. I saw that, and, you know, they're both very nice. But I'm not those two people. Those two guys, they are like, those are those like tactical dudes that like shoot a lot and stuff. That's like, they're like living the dream, right? So they get to use their gear and actually train and get really good with it all the time. And I'm sitting here doing science. Maybe someday I'll have employees, then I can shoot. But yeah, so I'm not those two guys, but I do know what makes sense for me right now in my shooting experience and my use cases for my firearms. What makes sense for me for a short 5.56 AR or Stoner platform is a silencer that isn't too long. That's what makes sense for me. And I was going to share some thoughts about that with you today. The other day, and it's topical because this is like an experience that I had. So the other day I was exercising a drill around my house, you know, cause I like to train and I like to do things, in general when I can. And I was, what I did was I cleared various places in my house, of a perceived threat. and I was using my 11 and a half inch machine gun. And I had on the gun, I had the Surefire, the SOCOM 556 RC2 on the gun there, on the three prong flash hider was attached there. And with that setup, with the way I was using it, I had enough clearance to fit in places I needed to fit. And I, although I look, and don't get it twisted, like I need training to understand like exactly how to do what I was doing correctly and minimize my risk of dying, like when I do it for real, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, I felt that the RC2 on the end of that gun was approaching the limit of how long I wanted that setup to be. I did. And so with that at 11 and a half inch upper, for me, it seemed like the RC2 was the limit for me. Like for my body. Like I'm 6 feet tall, pretty normal arm lengths for that height. My shooting stance is kind of hunched over, I guess, but like, you know, I'm not standing up straight as a board, but I'm walking around. I mean, I'm just trying to give you an idea of like how big I am. And like I'm in a house with like some small corridors. So I don't know. Like I felt like with that 11 and a half inch gun, like with the RC2, that was the limit. And cause, and you may be asking yourself, well, how, why does it matter how tall you are? Well, depending on your house, depending on where you're going in a building, you think you're just pointing the rifle straight, dude? Nah, man, you go up and down. Sometimes you're going up and down stairs, around stairs, around corners, rooms. Like if you're a taller guy like me, dude, you want your weapon to be shorter. Like that's, I don't know if anyone tells you that. Like I don't know if like Mr. Grantham Man or like the Lucas guy would say that, or like these other high speed guys. Like I don't know. I haven't taken a lot of high speed guy trainings. But like what I've noticed for my body and what I've noticed for like my friends that are shorter than me and my secret squirrel friends that I've known back in my time working for various people, those shorter dudes seem to be able to do stuff that I couldn't do, like with the rifles. I don't know. Is that why SOCOM guys are always short? I don't know. I don't know. When I used to work with those guys a lot, like all the guys I worked with were really short all the time. All the little secret squirrel dudes with the backpacks, they're always fucking super short. Like, I don't know. I don't know, man. Those guys were always small. Like, is that a thing? I don't know. They seem to be really small. I don't know. But yeah, so that's what I was noticing. I was going up and down stairs, like in this small stairway I have. And when I turned up to cover something or to peek around, and I was like, oh my God, I was just thinking about it. And I like the tip of that silencer, it didn't hit the ceiling or wall or the stairwell, but boy, did it come close. And I thought to myself, man, I was really paying attention to like movement and like really deliberate movement. And I know that if I had like a half inch more on this silencer right now, this would have not been as easy for me. And it would have been like more arduous. So I was thinking, well, at first I was thinking, well, gosh, wouldn't a 10.3 be better? But then I was thinking, well, no, this 11 and a half inch is really great too. Is it too long? Well, almost. It almost was. So that was interesting. And this is very, like, I know this is very abstract for you, and there's no picture, and like, you don't have the same house as me, and we're not, and obviously I'm not a super duper secret squirrel guy that is good at this, but yeah, I think this is worth talking about. And so what I did for the photo I took for this episode, this podcast episode, I put the 11 and a half inch upper with a prototype CGS 6mm arc silencer And look, don't ask when that silencer's coming out, because first of all, I don't work for CGS. You're going to have to ask them. Second of all, I don't even think that silencer is coming out. So relax. And so I'm going to put that in the photo. I put the Mark 18 with 10.3 inch upper with the Surefire RC2 in the photo. And then I put a Helios DT, which is the same silencer as a Hyperion K, but direct thread half 28 next to the Surefire. Okay. So all three of the silencers in the photo are about the same length, give or take. And that's why I picked them. That's why I put them there. Okay. So they're all the same length. The Helios QD, even with direct thread, is a little longer. You can actually see that in some of the other podcast photos from a previous episode, or also on the Instagram on either of those two accounts. So in fact, it's probably one with all the 5.56 silencers that I, a couple of episodes ago. Yeah. So that's there. So you can see the 5.56 ones and compared to the Helios QD, but yeah, that's a little longer. So, this kind of shows you something. This is when you start thinking about things like the Rugged Razor. Remember that? Remember the Rugged Razor? Several sound signature reviews ago, like last year. Remember the Rugged Razor? Short, right? It's a 30 caliber silencer, but, you know, Helios can shoot 30 cal through it, so, okay. So, Rugged Razor. Short. Same NK. That's another one. Short. But that's loud. So like I don't even want to go that loud. There's no reason. Because there's quieter, small, there's quieter options of the same size, right? So then this is the thing about 5.56 silencers. We're gonna be testing a bunch of them for you on the two rifle platforms I have in this picture here on this episode. But you need to think about what you need from the weapon system. You really do. What do you want to do with it? If you are not in a building, like, I mean, honestly, in my opinion, if you're not in a building and as long as the silencer is not too heavy for you, who cares how long it is? Who cares, dude? Like, really? Like, who cares? Doesn't matter, right? Like, within reason. But the minute you're in an old house with a bunch of tight hallways and you're clearing it in the middle of the night with your wife and kid at home, like, you're going to want to be able to get around. And yeah, okay, you might be saying, Jay, there's handguns. Use a handgun for that. Like, yeah, but a rifle's better? I mean, I like my rifle, dude. I don't know. It puts a lot of firepower on target. And it's very accurate. You can shoulder it. I don't know, man. I'm all about rifles, dude. Again, I'm not a high-speed secret squirrel guy, but give me my M16. Like, if you, like, you know, there's some people who are like, oh my God, I cannot believe you would use a machine gun for home defense. I'm like, really? I'm like, you don't want every advantage when you're, like, someone's attacking your home and your family, and you don't want every advantage? Like, dude, are you telling me you wouldn't use a suppressed machine gun with thermal? Oh, I'm sorry. You want to give them a head start? Bro. No. No one's coming to my house, dude. No one. Okay, anyone's coming to my house uninvited is not leaving. I mean, seriously, like what? Like what a dumb argument. People are like, well, I just wouldn't use XYZ because I don't think that I don't want the cops to take my. Yeah, I'm like, dude, this is your life, bro. Use every means available to survive. Like, what are you talking about? Like, yeah, I'm gonna use a machine gun. Kidding me? Speaking of machine guns. That picture that I'm posting with this, that's not my transferable. That's a post sample. I just made that. I built a machine gun this weekend, this past weekend. That's an Anderson lower receiver. You know the poverty pony people talk about because it's cheap and it has like a pony on the side and they compare it to Colt and like the Colt would be like, you know, the real pony. And then the Anderson, because it has a pony on the side, they would say poverty pony because it's cheap. Well, guess what? That thing's in tolerance and I milled it out. and they drill a third hole in it. Now it's a machine gun. And it has a Knight's Armament trigger guard in it. It has a Radian full auto ambi selector in it. And it's going to have a Geisley super select fire trigger in it as soon as the Brownells order gets here tomorrow. When this podcast airs, there will be a Brownells package at my doorstep tomorrow when this podcast airs. And I will get that. And I will put that in there because right now it has a mil-spec auto trigger. It's about to have or auto hammer and disconnect. It has an auto sear. You know, it's funny. Some people ask me, say, Jay, how does it work? Like, how do you get an auto trigger? And where do you get this auto sear? And isn't it all regulated? I'm like, no, man, none of it's regulated at all, actually. The only thing that's regulated is actual machine gun, and that's the receiver. So don't make machine guns unless you're allowed to. That's, I guess. And if you do, don't talk about it. So you know what I mean? You know what I mean? So yeah, so so that's that gun in the picture. That's not. I decided that I was like, you know what, I'm going to be doing a lot of crazy testing, and I don't need to be dragging a transferable machine gun around for that. So I decided, you know, it'd be more prudent to use a post sample. And that way, if something goes wrong, it's less have a headache because you can literally like, oh, we broke a post sample M16. Let's torch cut it and then take it off the books. And then you can make another one. You know what I mean? Like, who cares? Like, it doesn't, it's like, it's literally like people get so hung up on receivers. I'm just like, why are you getting so hung up on the receiver when you literally dictate what the parts are in it? And if it's in tolerance and it fits your upper, who cares? You're changing your grip anyway. You're changing your trigger group, your selector, your trigger guard. As long as like your magazines fit in it and the holes are in the right place and the walls are the right thickness, and it's not made out of plastic, and then the threads for the receiver extension are in the right place, and the buffer tube retention pin is in the right place. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, as long as everything's in the right place, who cares what it is? Who cares? Like, I do not understand what the hangups on this receiver stuff, guys. I mean, yeah, okay, the Radian has that crazy receiver. Like, my fiance has one. Where it has like all kinds of ambi controls and ball. Okay, that's cool. But we're not talking about that. I'm talking about just like a forged aluminum receiver. Like, you could take an 80% receiver, mill it out with like a drill press, and like it's in the white, and then spray paint it, not even anodize it, just spray paint it, and it'll be fine, most likely. Like, you're not going to break it. Like, people need to relax, dude. You guys don't understand, like, even what... Sometimes I think some people don't... They get so hung up on this receiver stuff. I'm like, guys, like... That is, like, the least of your worries. Like, all the other stuff in the operating system, that's important. Like, as long as your receiver is within reasonable tolerances, you'll be fine. And that's why everyone makes ARs, because it's easy. Because it should be easy. Praise be to Stoner. So yeah, and I didn't mean to necessarily go off on that tangent, but and this isn't a particularly technical topic for you, but it is just, it's something that I noticed let's go back to the topic here, the length of the 5.56 silencers on the platform. On the SBR, I say SBR. If it's a machine gun, it's not an SBR, but on a short barrel upper. Okay, it's cumbersome dealing with these ATF terms, but I did want to talk about this because I do think this is important. And one thing that we will see going forward is that length limitation will hit you for practicality in certain situations. So, this is, now, I'm serious. It's like, for the given length, which 5.56 silencer is going to give you the most operational capability, performance-wise? which is going to suppress sound the best for the length, even when you have ears on. Okay, even wearing hearing protection, you want the quietest silencer you can reasonably use. Why? Why? If you have ears on, some people think, oh, well, I have ears on, I don't care how loud it is. No, man, no. That's a big old mistake. Hearing damage is cumulative, my friends. You will have ear protection malfunctions. You will shoot a 5.56 SBR indoors. You do need to reduce the signature, even with ears. Law enforcement is very familiar with this. Like, I know that you guys are thinking about, like, when I talk about shooting ARs indoors, you're thinking about these high-speed, low-drag, secret squirrel guys with their night vision, and they go on Instagram, and they have all these really fancy videos. They all have tattoos, and they have skateboard companies and t-shirt companies. Like, that's, like, the hip thing, which is cool. I mean, it's really super fun to watch those videos. They're pretty dope. But, like, I'm not really talking about that as much as I am, like, about you in your house. Plus, like cops that do this all the time, dude. Like, you know how many like law enforcement officers have to go in houses with guns and do stuff? And like, put your politics aside. Forget about all that stuff right now. I'm talking about like SWAT teams. Like, I talk with these guys, dude. These guys talk with Pew Science about their gear and what they're using for and their training and how the silencer and the weapon system is affecting their buddy in the hallway with them when they're firing. You think it's just the shooter in a closed space? Bro, you know how many people there are in a freaking team? You know there's like firing going on and they still have to maintain situational awareness. You know they could have PPE. They could have comms, like, and like they have hearing protection and like comms going. But like, you think that like in a small space, it's going to be hunky-dory with an unsuppressed gun? No. So they put a silencer on it. Well, you think certain silencers behave differently in corridors? Yes. They certainly do. They most certainly do. So yeah, this is something that I got to thinking about, and I was just reminded of it because of my little micro-training event that I conducted in my home. And I thought maybe you want to hear about it because maybe you do the same thing. Maybe you have some thoughts to share with me. Maybe you say, you know, Jay, I heard about what you just said and I disagree because XYZ. Or you know what you didn't talk about, Jay? You didn't talk about 1, 2, 3. And I'd be like, thank you, sir, ma'am. Yeah, let me talk about it. Okay. Eventually, I will say Pew Science may release suppression rating data with hearing protection combined. It is possible. It is. I actually have talked about this with a few of you, and I've talked about it on the podcast briefly. The models for protected hearing, which are dependent upon the hearing protection apparatus and the coupling and the transfer function with the inner ear, those models are not as well refined as the unprotected ear models. But guess what? We have all the time in the world because we already have the raw waveform data from the guns, from the suppressed weapons, remember? That's right. Pew Science has the largest database of real suppressed small-arm sound signature data in the entire world. We do. No one else has the data we have like this. No one does. I don't care who you are, what country you're in, what gun company you work for, what military branch you work for. No one has the data we have. Nobody. Nobody but Pew Science. I know it. No one is taking the amount of data with the rigor we are at the sample rate we're doing in the repeatable way we're doing it. So we have the most data in the world, and that data is forever here. So I can do whatever I want with it. What does that mean? Well, if I have the load input, which is the pressure time history, I can load a response model with it, right? Well, do we have to have the response model right now? Well, no. No, it can be improved later. I still have the data. The data is just as valid. See what I mean, Jellybean? So, you know, some people have asked, you know, there is a non-trivial amount of people that have asked me about, Jay, how does the suppression rating change when I'm wearing ears? Well, it goes up, but how far does it go up? Does it go to infinity? Well, no, it doesn't. Does it go to 100? Well, it depends on the gun. Depends on the silencer, right? So I'll leave you with that for now. Just some food for thought. I know this is a really weird topic. I usually give you a more point, like a more purposeful topic, but that was like half rant, half thought-provoking topic for you. Okay. Let's move in. Let's move into topic three at a time of 50 minutes and 15 seconds. Okay, listener questions. Oh man, tell you what. Let us continue our journey together. We're gonna go back into our spreadsheet right now. And we're gonna hit more of your questions. Maybe not a lot. Let's see. We're about 50 minutes in. We're less than an hour in, so be all right. We're making good time today. It's hard catching up after this Memorial Day. Spending time with family, you know. It's, oh my gosh, you gotta. It's just the grind. You got to grind. What happens is I have all these other topics I want to hit, and so I think what these other topics do is they end up taking away from having a big question episode. You know what I mean? So I may curtail some future topics to knock more of these out, like more of these questions out, all at once for you. Maybe I don't know, but right now we're gonna see. Let's see how much we can get to today. Let me get into the spreadsheet. Yeah. Okay. I mean, I really do enjoy this. This is quite good. Okay. Let's see. So the last time we visited our spreadsheet, we left off on question 91, a local question 20 of the second question solicitation. And the question was from this lady or gentleman, do you expect 45 ACP to be substantially louder than 9mm subsonic through equivalent silencers? And I went on to answer that by essentially saying there is no equivalent because, 45 pistol silencers are inherently different than 9mm silencers, and there are various technical reasons why that is. So if you'd like to know more about that, the answer to that question, please return to the previous episode, and your knowledge will be gained. Your quest for knowledge will be satisfied. Your thirst will be quenched. Okay, let's move into question 92. Sub question 21. Let's see. Let me get some water here. Okay. Let's see, make sure I didn't lose that. Okay, just making sure. Let's see. What, in your opinion, is the most versatile caliber when suppressed? Versatile caliber. Well, for what, sir or ma'am? I mean, good question, but let's see if we can dissect this. Like, for what? Versatile for what? Well, I guess, okay, since you're saying versatile, you're probably referring to the most amount of uses, I guess. Well, that's the definition of versatility, right? So I think this actually goes back to a question from the previous episode regarding what I would get if I could only get one silencer. And my answer was a 22 silencer. I mean, like, is 22 the most versatile cartridge? In some ways, kind of is. I mean, you know, let's see. You can hunt with it for small game, right? That's like super important. You can kill squirrels and little stuff to eat. That's really important. You can shoot, you could probably kill more stuff with 22. You just got to make sure your shot placement is crazy. You can shoot, target shoot to train. You can plink for fun. And that's incredibly, like, major, right? So that's three incredibly major uses, and it's cheap. And with the 22 silencer, it's ultra quiet. So on the right host, man, you really don't even need hearing protection, honestly. Like on a bolt action 22 rifle suppressed, for example, I'm qualifying that statement. It's comically, like, a good silencer on a 22 bolt action rifle of a long enough barrel is comically quiet, like quieter than a pellet rifle quiet. Like, check out Sound Signature Review 6.1, the very first one, Rugged Oculus on a 16-inch bolt gun. That's not even, that's like, that's why I haven't even released that many more 22 science or tests yet, because I'm like, let's, I mean, I know it's important because frankly, there's some 22 sponsors that aren't that good, but a lot of them nowadays are really good. So just look at that review. You're like, oh, that's quiet. I'm like, yeah, dude, it totally is. So another really versatile, okay, so that's, okay, that's my 22 kind of answer for you, but like another really versatile caliber, and you said caliber, I'm gonna treat that word like cartridge, if that's okay. Because when you say caliber, you're really talking about the size, right, in tenths of an inch. So if I say like, or in hundredths of an inch, I guess, right, because you'd say 30 hundredths, 3/10. 30 hundredths would be 30 caliber, right? 0.3 inches. 0.3 inches. Okay, so I'm going to say cartridge. So I would say, which is like not only the diameter, but the length of the entire cartridge itself. Like, for example, a really versatile cartridge would be 9 by 19. That's 9 millimeter diameter, 19 millimeter length. So 9 by 19, 9 millimeter, like 9 millimeter Luger, right? Like the 9mm you're familiar with, like for like a Glock 19 or like a Sig 226 or a HK USP or a HK MP5. These are all 9mm Luger small arms. That's a very versatile cartridge. You know, self-defense handguns, combat handguns, and you can suppress those. Submachine guns, M11, MP5, Uzi, you know, carbine, you know, 9mm, you call them PCCs, pistol caliber carbine. I hate that word, but that's what they are, I guess. Okay, so similarly, 45 ACP, that's another cartridge. If it's the same role I just talked about, it's inherently subsonic, which is a plus, but 9mm is probably a smarter choice most of the time. So those are some versatile calibers. You can't hunt, you can hunt with them. I mean, my buddy killed a whitetail with a 9mm Glock. Not something I would do, but he definitely did. So that happens. Oh, that reminds me. I need to pick up my mounts from the taxidermist. I'm gonna make a 1 second. Pick up European mounts. Oh man, yeah, I got those 2 European mounts from this past season. I haven't picked them up yet. I'm a slacking hunter is what I am. Man, good thing I just remember that. So okay, back to your question. Sorry. I guess I'm having some trouble thinking of how to quantify most versatile cartridge, because without knowing exactly what you're doing with the cartridge, I know that sounds weird because you're asking about versatility, but I think 300 Blackout is probably versatile in that you can use super or sub in an AR or a bolt gun. So that's like a pretty versatile cartridge, right? That's you can use super sub 9mm too, but you don't get the terminal ballistic advantages of 300 Blackout in doing that. So 300 Blackout's very versatile. You could also say that 5.56 is versatile, right? Because you could use it for self-defense, for plinking, for hunting, for whatever. You can do everything with 300 Blackout, you can do 5.56, except the subsonic part. Right, because subsonic 5.56 is like 22 long rifle. No, it's heavier bullet weight, but it's stupid. So I don't know. Plinking, hunting, carry a lot. 5.56 is good. I don't know. You can suppress anything you want to suppress. Anything can be suppressed. Anything. Any cartridge. So I don't know. I don't think I answered your question. This is one of those questions where like I might have to say like I don't know the answer. Or that it's going to depend on you. I think the answer is going to depend on you and what you needed to do. Let me make sure I read it right. What in your opinion is the most versatile caliber? Let me read it differently. What in your opinion is the most versatile cartridge when suppressed? Versatile cartridge when suppressed. When suppressed. Oh my God, I misunderstood your question. You're asking if I have something suppressed, what can I do the most? which cartridge, when it's suppressed, could do the most for me. Which is the same thing I said earlier, but this is a nuance. I think I'm getting the thrust of your question. Like, you're basically asking, if I had a gun and it had a silencer permanently attached, and I could only have that one gun, and I want to do everything with it, but it had to be suppressed, what would it be? 300 blackout. I think 300 blackout's the answer. It's got to be, right? I don't know if you're following along. Those of you following along at home here, hey, send me your DM me or tech@pewscience.com if you have a different idea. But I think with this lady or gentleman, I think the answer to their question is 300 blackout. Because if I was forced to keep one cartridge and it had to be suppressed, what's the most versatile thing? Well, you would want something subsonic for stealth, and you would want something to kill expediently, which is supersonic. So 300 blackout. Because you could put it in an AR or a bolt gun. Yeah, 300 blackout. Okay. That's my answer. It's my opinion. It's probably not the answer. It is a answer. It's my answer to you right now. And it's funny, I don't even, like, 300 blackout's cool, but I'm so jaded shooting it for testing. Like, I don't even care about it right now. Like, for right now, I just want 5.56 so I can shoot. Like, I just need, you know what's going to happen to me? I'm going to end up finding, like, someone to help me with ammunition. Then I'm going to buy a lot, and then I'm going to actually shoot. Wouldn't that be great? Okay. Okay, topic. Question 93, sub-question 22 in the second question solicitation. Oh, by the way, sorry. Thank you for that question, that versatile caliber question. I'm sorry it took me so long to get the answer. I had to talk through it. Sometimes I have to talk through it. Okay. I had to work it out. Question. So thank you. Good question. Question 22. How does a larger caliber rating transfer to smaller calibers, i.e., a 7.62 dual, quote unquote, silencer on a 5.56 AR? All right, let me repeat this question. Let me read this question again, repeat it. Let me learn from last time. Let me learn from this previous question and do this right. How does a larger cartridge rating? I'm changing the words for no reason. Let me start over. Okay. Focus. Okay. Game face. Do it. How does a larger caliber rating transfer to smaller calibers, i.e. 7.62 do it all silencer on a 5.56 AR? All right. I don't know why I can't. Maybe I did eat pad thai again. I don't know if it's a brain fog here. That, by the way, they said, I asked for hot. I didn't ask for Thai hot. They had like a bunch of different levels, and it started at medium. And I was like, you're starting at medium? Bro, your hotness scale needs to be calibrated. I don't know what does this Thai place. I'm just addicted to their pad Thai right now. It's amazing. Okay, let's get to this question. It is an excellent question. I think I know where you're going with this, sir, ma'am. I think I know where you're going with this. When you talk about rating, you might be talking about the manufacturer's rating for the silencer. Or you might be talking about the Pew Science suppression rating, which are two different things. So I don't know. But what I do know is I'm going to answer your question anyway. 7.62 silencers on 5.56 generally do well. They generally do well because they have a larger bore than needed. We're talking about the AR platform. You're going to have a higher mass flow rate. It's relatively high for the cartridge. So if you use them on semi or automatic host weapons in 5.56, they're generally going to allow the weapon system to perform well, generally. Okay, the issue you're going to run into is going to be weight, length, and sound. If a 7.62 silencer is long enough, and if the internals are designed to be efficient at high pressure suppression, it's going to suppress 5.56 pretty well. But some 7.62 silencers are loud on 7.62. And therefore, they're also going to be loud on 5.56. Okay. And this is sometimes in their nature. It's not, it's not a blanket absolute statement. There are exceptions, but it will be rare to have a silencer that performs poorly on 7.62 and then perform really well on 5.56 in general. Like, you're not going to have like a crappy silencer in 7.62 and all of a sudden it's like a wonder, a wunderkind in 5.56. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. Okay? I mean, you might run across some people that say, man, I tell you what, I put this 7.62, so I put this on my 5.56, it sounds so good. I'll be like, it does? What if you shot, dude? Like, are you deaf? You might be. I am. No. But yeah. No. If you have a really loud 7.62 silencer and you put it on 5.56, don't expect it to be a miracle worker just because it's a little bigger. If it's really loud on 7.62, it's supersonic, probably has an issue with the design. Okay. Or it's not intended to be quiet at all. Maybe they're just using it as a fancy flash hider. I mean, I've seen crazier stuff. So, I don't know if I'm answering your question. I mean, I think having a 30 caliber bore for a do-it-all rifle silencer, because you did ask do-all silencer on 5.56. I think having a 30 caliber bore for a do-all rifle silencer is smart. If you don't shoot a lot, I think, well, it's smart for a couple of reasons. It might help with certain things. I mean, there's so many things it can help with. It helps with back pressure. It helps with accuracy. It can help with accuracy with a bad silencer design that would normally affect accuracy on 7.62. Maybe it won't affect accuracy on 5.56 because the bore is so big that the projectile doesn't experience undue cross-shedding or turbulence, for example. Maybe with 7.62, the bore is such that it's just sucks, and it's like creating some kind of yaw in the bullet path. I don't know. It just depends on the silencer. It can be very complicated. I don't know. So yeah, 30 caliber bore in 5.56, it can be smart. But I think the more you shoot, the more I would recommend you have a dedicated silencer for each gun. You all get to that point, so just don't fight it. You think you're only going to buy one silencer. You really do, but you're not. Let's be honest, guys. Don't try to be a hero here. What's like, and I know we talked about Fight Club earlier in the podcast. It was like the first rule of Fight Club. And then we talked about PEW science. Like, the first rule of PEW science is like to tell everyone about PEW science. Well, the first rule of the NFA is to always have something pending. Okay? If you haven't figured that out yet, well, I'm sorry for your wallet, but the first rule of the NFA game is always have something pending, dude. Like, if you're not an SOT, then, which, I mean, almost none of you are that are listening. I mean, some of you are, obviously, but the vast majority of you are not SOTs. Like, if you're just a consumer and you're transferring things on Form 4 or Form 1, you're making things on Form 1, like, don't. You always got to have something pending, homie. What are you doing? How is it gonna make your arsenal big and strong? You gotta take your vitamins and drink your milk, say your prayers. As Hulk Hogan would say, you gotta get strong. You gotta have a lot of guns. So yeah. I'd recommend you have a silencer for every gun. Now, for a long time, I will tell you a story. I've said this before. For a long time, I would run a rifle silencer, my hunting rifles, with QD. And I just one silencer, single silencer. I get back to hunting camp. Both guns were already zero for that one silencer. I get back to hunting camp. I take off that silencer off my bolt gun. I put it on my AR-308. I'd set up for pigs. That AR-308 was dialed in for pigs with thermal. I go out at night. Or you know what? I stay out the whole day and night with both rifles, and then I switch the silencer back and forth depending on what I was doing with them because I could. I'd keep both the rifles on a little gun rack on my ATV, and it was super easy to swap the silencers in the field with QD. And that's one of the cool things about quick detach QD and the latch tool. Didn't have to use a tool. I could take them off, and if it was getting a little stuck, I'd put on my gloves, use a little bit of elbow grease, get that silencer off that gun. I'm not doing a carbine course with it and carbon locking it. I'm hunting. So I knew it was going to come off. Okay? You can carbon lock anything if you really try. I think even Mr. Grand Thumb Man talked about it. We talked about that ourselves. We actually talked about that personally, he and I. He said he was going to say it in the video. I said, you should. You should. So yeah, you have options with this. I think, back to your question, so how does the caliber rating from manufacturer transfer to smaller calibers? It means that if they've rated it for a high pressure round, it'll probably do okay with a lower pressure round. Or at least in a lower energy round. Probably will. Check with the manufacturer. It could be the barrel length could be abusive though. If you have something like 300 blackout that's a larger caliber than 5.56 because it's a larger diameter, and it's like a subsonic 300 blackout silencer, and you put it on a short barrel 5.56, homie, you better be dang sure your silencer can take the insane muzzle blast from like a 10-inch 5.56. 10-inch 5.56 is not normal. It's not normal. It's half the barrel length the cartridge is designed for. What happens when you cut the barrel length in half? Well, you got a lot of energy still. It hasn't blown down yet, and there's quite a lot of hot plasma stream coming out of the muzzle there. It's going to cut through stuff like butter. Like butter, as they say. It's not good for you or your gun. So you use a silencer, but yeah. I don't know. Suppression rating-wise, if you're asking about that, well, depends on the host weapon. Depends on the system. It depends. It's too complicated to address in one question like that. So, okay. Let's do a couple more. How are we doing on time right now? Okay. Not the worst, not the best. Okay, we're going to keep going. Thank you for that question. It was very good. It was very good. I don't know exactly I don't know if I answered it. I think I did. I think I gave you enough information. If you're asking about sound, it's hard for me to tell you. We're going to have to talk about that in more detail later. Okay, one second. Okay. Okay, question 94. Sub-question 23. Hey, Jay. Hi, listener. Hey, Jay, I don't know if you have ever talked about it. I'm on episode 40, but tell us about your lifting, etc. Ah, my lifting. It was a personal question. Okay. I will share with you what I am comfortable sharing publicly. How about that? Is that okay? Deal? If you want to know more, we can talk offline. I'd be happy to talk more personal details. This podcast goes to a wide audience, so I'd rather not just, you know, broadcast my personal life to you. But I've lifted weights for most of my adult life. I started by myself, alone, just doing push-ups. And I bought some dumbbells, really small. I think I still have them. There's some 20... Oh, I can't remember if they're 20-pounders or 25-pounders. Little iron, like hexagonal iron dumbbells, like just real simple. I bought those from a local sporting goods store when I was in high school, and or maybe even middle school. I think it was high school, and I did push-ups. I did push-ups on the dumbbells. On the bars there, I did, you know, curls and shoulder raises. And I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't have an instructor or a coach. I did what I saw in the movies and stuff by myself in my room. Like, that's just learn, you know, by myself and reading book. Like, there was no internet. I mean, there kind of was. Yeah, there was internet, but it wasn't like good internet. It wasn't like easy. It wasn't like it is now. You could just pull up YouTube. There was no YouTube. So yeah, I just did that. By myself, sit-ups, the last sit-ups. I really enjoyed it. I did it by myself. And I got to college, and I met some really, really great people, like some cool folks, and I started training. Mostly bodybuilding-type stuff, actually, at first. I got really into it, really into fitness, running, lifting, getting absolutely jacked. and tan as possible. You got to keep in mind, I was in college. I had been lifting in high school a little bit by myself. By college, like as a man, like your testosterone levels are peaking, dude. You are like basically like you're fervently able to cultivate mass, as they say. Like I was in engineering school. So what did I do? Well, I studied and lifted. 5 a.m. workout, 6 days on, 1 day off. Undergrad through grad school, non-stop, dude. I met some powerlifters from the university team. I tried that too. I lifted with them. I was really into it. I kept lifting all through my adult life, making time for the gym always. The gym, it is the one constant, or used to be the one constant, and I would sacrifice things for it. I mean, then I'd get smarter about it, but I would still put it first. I would put it first. Never miss training days. Would never miss them. I would never, ever miss a training day. Actually, barely even drink alcohol at all, because it would affect my gains, dude. Like, you can't drink alcohol. It'd affect your gains. Like, it lowers your testosterone. If you drink alcohol, it lowers your testosterone level. I don't care what you think you know about that. It is not. It doesn't work. If you want to make gains, you are not drinking. You're just not. And I was hardcore about that. And I guess almost about a decade ago or so, I met the famous Gene Bell. He's a multi-time world champion powerlifter. He is considered by many people in the sport to be one of, if not the greatest, powerlifters of all time. Like, I know some of you know who Ed Cohn is. I know Ed Cohn. I had dinner with Ed and his family, dude. I know who Ed Cohn is. And I'm here to tell you, like, and okay. You think Ed is the greatest powerlifter of all time? Well, why would you say that Ed is the great? Do you know who Gene Bell is? Gene squatted 843 pounds at a body weight of 181. And you can go on YouTube and see that. It was the Budweiser record breaker meet in Hawaii. You got Steve Machine Gun Goggins. You know who Steve Machine Gun Goggins is? You know Steve Goggins? Steve Goggins is still out there. Steve Goggins is a heck of a powerlifter. He's unreasonably strong. And Steve Goggins would walk onto the stage shooting a machine gun in the air. That's right, Steve Machine Gun Goggins. That was his nickname. This is back when men were men, dude. This is like, so Gene, he's great. And 843 at a body weight of 181. Gene did bodybuilding, he did powerlifting. Retired from the U.S. Air Force, by the way. Gene is the man. One of the greatest men that I personally know. One of my greatest friends. And he did, you know, he did that squat in primitive lifting gear, not like the powerlifting equipment you see today. So about 10 years ago or so, but a little bit more recently than that, let's just say about around a decade or so ago, I was looking for a sport. I was in the time of my life where I kind of needed some friends and there's just things going on. And Gene saw me in the gym one day. I was training by myself, like I usually do. And he asked me, he asked me if I had ever powerlifted. I told him kind of, but I never competed in it. He told me he could train, me with the team. Like I could go train with the team if I liked. And if I liked it, maybe I could come back. And I said, okay. So I looked and saw, I always saw those guys lifting in the gym. I was like, I don't want to be part of their reindeer games. They probably have their own friends. They don't need, you know, I think I'll just stick to what I've always done by myself. But then he talked to me. I said, okay. So I went that day and I did a whole team workout with them that day. And then Gene, after that, I stayed late. I was in the locker room or something, or changing to go home, and he asked me, he said, "Hey, you want to join the team?" And I did. I said, "Yeah, I do. I do. That's really nice. I'd never been on a team before." You know? And so I went on to compete in the USAPL. I got to the national level at a meet once. I won some local meets. I competed in the 181 pound weight class and the 198 pound weight classes. And remember, these are not 24-hour weigh-ins like those other federations. This is 2-hour weigh-ins. So you got to make weight 2 hours before it's platform time. Okay, this is like legit. And then I was in 205 later when they changed the weight class to match the IPF weight classes. This is all drug tested. I compete in drug tested federations. Okay, this is like the pinnacle of powerlifting sport. This isn't like backyard federation. This is when like the IPF actually was like super awesome, and like the USAPL, like this is like legit drug free strength sport. I'm not taking anything away from people who do drugs to lift. That's fine. That's their thing. But that's not my thing. And so like this is legit. And I don't know. I made some of my best and closest friends in the gym, and through powerlifting too. PEW Science actually has taken a front seat, and my lifting has suffered as a result of that. It's easy to blame that. It's easy to blame that and blame COVID. I don't know. It is easy to make excuses, right? But one thing Gene Bell always told me, and he still tells me, is you have to be stronger than your excuses are. He always tells me you cannot make up a missed training. You'll never get that day back. If you miss a day of training, you'll never get it back. And you have to be stronger than your excuses. Okay? So I think that's important for everyone to know in life. I'm not as strong as I used to be, but I'm getting back into slowly but surely. The COVID did suck. And it created an environment in which I was less likely to train with the frequency that I used to train with. But I also had personal choices that affected that, and PEW Science does as well. And so, I don't know. I will say that's all I'm going to say, but publicly, I will say lifting weights changed my life. And it'll change your life too. It will change your life. And it is actually lifting weights and, getting strong in strength sports. It is one of the most important things you can do for yourself physically and mentally. It will change your life. I promise. If you start lifting weights, if you've never lifted weights regularly and you start doing it and it doesn't change your life, tech at pewscience.com. All right, let's do one more. Oh, that got a little personal. Actually, I almost got a little choked up there. That's like a very emotional topic for me. Some of you may not understand. You know what? A lot of you do understand. A lot of you do understand what a brotherhood is like. When you make friends that are like brothers to you, because you go through things together, you know what I mean. When you go through really hard stuff, and people are there for you, you know, like what is that like? How many people listening have those type of friends that are with you through essentially battle? You know, like when one of our training partners, when one of our teammates had, you know, 800 pounds on their back, and they're counting on us to save their life if something goes wrong. Do you think there's trust involved with that? You think the new lifter that's benching in a bench shirt because they're doing equipped lifting, you think a new lifter with 500 pounds over their face is trusting their spotter that day when they've never held that type of weight in their hands before? You think that happens? It does. It's real. That's life or death stuff, man. I mean, some of you in the military, you have more serious life-threatening things to deal with, sure. But this is like a normal thing that people go through. So You know, you make friends. You ever play football? You know, all those, you know, there's a team sport. You know, you mess up, you lose together, you win together, stuff like that. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't know, that type of brotherhood when you're like working really hard for something. And we always had a saying on our team. It was like, if you bleed in the gym so you don't bleed on the platform. You know, so you basically the gist of that, I mean, the meaning behind that saying, that rather crude saying, is go through the hardship in preparation and training so that when it comes to game time, you dominate and you have no vulnerability and you win. I apply that to everything I do in life. Everything I do, I apply those principles. Gene Bell has taught me so much about not only lifting weights, but life. And I use that every day. I use it for PEW Science. Everything I do for you, this podcast, the sound signature reviews, this is all a calculated effort. I don't mess around. I don't half-ass stuff. Okay, like I'm here to win. I'm here to be the absolute best at everything I do. Always, I'm here to completely dominate every effort that I put forth. I think I said this, I kind of alluded to this. Remember when I did that podcast with Kevin Brigham? You remember that? A lot of people who don't like Kevin. Kevin and I have something in common though. We're very aggressive. And we don't like to lose. Okay? So take everything else about that guy, whatever. But what I'm saying, I'm talking about those traits. And that's like, some people have that, some people don't. And some people are never going to have that. Some people are never going to have that aggression and that drive. But some people are born with it. And some people learn it. But I'm confident that if you want to succeed in life and you really want something, having that attitude is going to help. Okay. All right. Life Lessons by Jay. Question 95. We'll do one more. Question 95. Sub-question 24 from the second solicitation. So, first of all, thank you for asking about my lifting. That lifting means a lot to me. More than I think you may have realized before you asked that question. And buckle up if you ever ask me about lifting, because I might talk your ear off. Question 24, which other optimized silencer host weapons do you plan to test? AR platform or other? Good question. Excellent question, actually. MP5, for sure. Also, let me make a note to myself. Call HK. Let me talk to them about that. MP5, for sure. Also, rotating delayed blowback AR from CMMG. Let me make another note to myself. Call CMMG. Oh, I need a secretary. That'd be so cool. We need to know how they compare in signature, the MP5 and the rotating delay blowback CMMG. And I think they're going to be extremely similar. The crux of this is, it's not only sound, we need to figure out. Frankly, here's the thing. The AR platform, and I'm gonna, sir, ma'am, thank you for this question. I'm gonna answer it, but I need to depart momentarily. This is important. Some of you that are new to this 9mm game with things that are not handguns, so that's like submachine guns, let's just call them that for now. Some of you that are new to this and you like the MP5, that's good. You should like the MP5 because it's a good gun. But one thing you may not understand if you don't have an MP5 and you're lusting after one thing you may not understand is that it is an old weapon platform. The barrel is pinned and welded into a trunnion that's like, it's integrated into this folded stamped receiver, and it's antiquated. It doesn't come apart. Like the receiver and the barrel are one piece. Like they're one. I mean, they're not one piece. They're just together forever until you drill out something and press it out, but it's in there. And when you separate the trigger housing from the receiver of the MP5, it's sort of like an AR-15 in that you do have the fire control group separate and the recoil operation in the upper, but there are things about it that are so integral to the way it works that are not replaceable easily that make it just cumbersome to deal with, like, mechanically. Like, for example, like, the way the bolt works, it's delayed roller locked. You have this locking piece that goes into the bolt, and it has these chamfered kind of edges, and they impinge upon these little rollers. Well, those rollers are forced out of the bolt house, the bolt OD, and they impinge upon the receiver steel. And like, if all of this is not properly dialed in, like, it's not going to work exactly the same every time. And like, MP5s are actually very resilient when it comes to that part. Like, the only thing about an MP5 that like wears out relatively fast is the extractor spring. Everything else, it pretty much runs like a sewing machine. When you get to like a super high round count MP5, what'll happen is like you might crack the receiver near where the rollers engage, or you might need to rebuild your bolt for like to have proper bolt gap. I mean, and there's specs for that. Well, you can use it with a feeler gauge to set it up right. I've actually done, like, back in the day to like really make an MP5 crazy suppressed. I've actually changed the bolt gap so much that I got like more delay. Like, you can do that with a locking piece too, but you can also do it with bolt gap because you can use different diameter rollers. You can do crazy stuff with an MP5. Like, if you're really into it, I mean, it's really expensive because all the parts are stupid expensive. But you can tune an MP5. I don't know how many of you have actually done that before, but I've done it. I've tuned MP5s. And it's just physics. It's just like you tune, just like when you use a different bolt carrier group. In an AR with a different cam path. Well, the one thing about the MP5 that's adjustable is you can change the rollers out and the locking piece. So in some respects, it is even more tunable than an MP5 action in a certain way, although you can change buffer weight. Well, you can. There's tungsten powder for anti-bounce in the bolt carrier in an MP5. But okay, I just said a lot of stuff. I digress. The reason I was bringing that up is because one of the reasons why I need to test the CMMG radial, or I'm sorry, rotating delay blowback AR, one of the reasons I need to test that is because if you can have an AR based system, a stoner based, it's not really stoner, but it kind of is, an AR based system compete with an MP5 and do everything an MP5 can do, but with the ergonomics and the accessories of an AR-15, do that. There does come a point when you need to throw away old stuff. And frankly, the MP5, it's awesome, but like, dude, it's overweight for what it is. And if you can delay the unlocking of a bolt with a different mechanism and it works in like a pseudo stoner platform, just do that. I heard that some people had some problems with the CMMG extractors. I don't know if that's been rectified. I imagine it would be. I know that people run them full auto, and I think the cyclic rate can be similar to the MP5, and the smoothness and feel can be similar to the MP5. That's important, dude. So that's what I want to test those, and I want to test more than just the sound. 22 pistols, that's another thing I want to test. And if you guys forgot what this question was due to my rant, this person is asking, what other optimized silencer host weapons do I plan to test? And okay, so 22 pistols, like, what's the quietest? What can we just not have to use hearing protection with because they're awesome? Which actions stay closed long enough? Not all of them. Some 22 pistols suck suppressed. So we need to figure that out. In the AR platform, in addition to the CMMG, we need to what makes a 300 blackout semi-auto gun tick, really? What can we do with the dwell time? What are the tricks? Can we do tricks? Can we lengthen or shorten the dwell time? What happens when we tune it? What happens with the Surefire OBC in 300 blackout? What if we were to make it a highly optimized Honey Badger that was like way better than the Honey Badger in operation? And when I say that, I don't mean the Honey Badger is unreliable, because I think the Honey Badger is very reliable. What I'm actually speaking about is what's optimum quiet suppressed use for a gun like the Honey Badger with like blowback to your face. Can we fix that? I've seen the Honey Badgers being shot. It looks like it's Gas City, full auto. What if we could do it where it wasn't like that? So that's something I want to look at. So yeah, need to characterize a lot of things. That's a good question. Thank you for that question. Okay, that's enough questions for now. I'm going to highlight that. I probably could have gotten deeper in that, but I'm exhausted right now. It's super late. Okay. Yeah, let's move in. Okay, I hope that was fun. So kind of a unique question period in this podcast, but there we are. All right, let's go ahead. Let's move into topic 4 at a time of 1 hour, 35 minutes and 43 seconds. Okay. Welcome to new members of Pew Science. Your support means the world. It really does. And I actually hope that through the topics we've talked about in this podcast, I give you a little bit, maybe a little bit of a personal insight, some of my philosophy or my philosophies, and some of the little, I don't know if you could call it like a peek behind the curtain of like stuff that I'm dealing with and do to make Pew Science work. Some of the sacrifices that I've made in general, I don't really go into a lot of that. There's not really your business, but my effort, and I call it my effort because it is mine. This would not happen without me. it is spurred on by you. It would also not happen without you. You see, we are not alone and separate. We are together in this. So I thank you for that. It is important. And your support does mean the world. And when I say that, and I'm bringing this up because when I say your support means the world, I'm not blowing your skirt up, homie. I'm not being like, oh yeah, like you're so great. Thank you for the follow. You know, like those gun people. It's like, whatever, man. Like, I'm serious. Like, thank you. Because this is like really hard. So what I was gonna hit the emails tonight. I'm gonna try to hit some of the emails tonight. I'm sorry. Look, maybe I'm not sorry, because Memorial Day was spent with my loved ones, okay? And so I'm a little behind so from that. And then and as a result, professional activities and took some catching up time, you know. So yeah, I'm going to reach out to you folks soon. If you haven't gotten an email from me, or if I hadn't answered your email, it's because there's just not enough time in the day sometimes. And so it goes to the next day. Yeah, I'll get to it. So don't worry, you are not forgotten. You are never forgotten. You are the Pew Science family. You are. And you are the army of supporters who fuels the effort. You spread the word. You educate the public. You are helping to normalize suppressed small arms. So thank you, okay? Dealers, manufacturers, distributors, consumers, Sansa Shop, Pew Science. The collective we, all thank you all for this. We will do this. We will do this together. We will create the best silencer industry the world has ever seen. We will bring back the glory days. We will force innovation together. Together, we will do this. Okay, Godspeed. Stay tuned this week for more data. Stay safe. Keep your mags loaded. Okay, talk to you folks again soon. Bye.